Well, good morning, Cornerstone family. Thank you for joining us online. We're going to do some worship right now, and then we're going to study God's Word. Let's worship with Pastor Joey.
Well, good morning, church family. Let's sing to the Lord with all our heart, all our mind, our soul. Amen. Come on, let's sing this with me. What to say, Lord, it's you gave me life, and I can't explain just how much you mean to me now. That you save me, Lord. I give all that I am to you, and every day I can be a light that shines your name. Be a light that shines your name. Every day, Lord, I'll learn to stand upon your word, and I pray that I might come to know you more, that you would guide me in every single step I take, and every day I can be a light unto the world. Every day it's you I live for. Every day I follow after you. Every day I walk with you, my Lord. Every day, Lord, I'll learn to stand upon your word, and I pray that I might come to know you more, you would guide me in every single step I take, and every day I can be a light unto the world. Every day it's you I live for. Every day I follow after you. Every day I walk with you, my Lord. Come on, we sing, it's you I live for every day. With all our mind, our heart, our soul, come on, lift it up to the Lord, we sing. It's you I live for every day. It's you I live for every day. It's you I live for every day. Sing it to the Lord, it's you I live for. It's you I live for every day. It's you I live for every day. It's you I live for every day.
Come on, every day.
Every day, it's you I live for. Every day I follow after you. Every day I walk with you, my Lord. Every day, it's you I live for. Every day I follow after you. Every day I walk with you, my Lord. I live for every day.
It's you I live for, Lord. It's you I live for every day. Amen. We worship.
Come on, more love, more power. More love, more power. More of you in my life. More love, more power. More of you in my life. I will worship you with all of my heart. I will worship you with all of my mind. I will worship you with all of my strength. You are my Lord. You are my God.
See, more faith, more passion.
More faith, more passion. More of you in my life. More faith, more passion, more of you in my life. And I will worship you with all of my heart. And I will worship you with all of my mind. And I will worship you with all of my strength. You are my Lord. You are my God. And I will worship you with all of my heart. And I will worship you with all of my mind. And I will worship you with all of my strength. You are my Lord. For you are my Lord.
Yes, you are.
You are my Lord. You are my God.
Come on, lift your hearts together.
And I will worship you with all of my heart. And I will worship you with all of my mind. And I will worship you with all of my strength. You are my Lord. You are my God. This morning dawns, evening fades, you inspire songs of praise that rise from earth to touch your heart and glorify your name. Is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name. Let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to say but your name. In your name,
Jesus, in your name we pray. Come and fill our hearts today. Lord, give us strength to live for you and glorify your name. Is a strong and mighty tower. Your name is a shelter like no other. Your name. Let the nations sing it louder, 'cause nothing has the power to say. Nothing. 'Cause nothing has the power to say. Nothing has the power to say,
worship you, Jesus. Your name. Father God, we praise you. We thank you that you alone are worthy of praise. We worship the name of Jesus. With all our mind, all our heart, and all our soul, we worship you. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your grace, your mercy. I pray you be with all the family, all the brothers and sisters at home. Continue to be with them. Watch over, protect them. And I pray, God, just open our hearts to your message. Bless our pastor, God, as he speaks right now. Fill our homes, fill this place, fill our hearts with your Holy Spirit. Father, we long to hear from you. We give you all the glory, honor, and praise. In Jesus' name, all the family say, amen.
Well, good morning, Cornerstone family. Thank you for joining us today. I'm so excited. Today is Palm Sunday. That means next Sunday is Easter Sunday. We're going to worship Jesus Christ rising from the dead as we do every Sunday. We're so excited for you to join us. We have a special gift next week for you and your family and your friends. Everyone is going to get a special gift. We are giving away Elise Drobel's A Case for Christ. We're giving away a new study guide for the book of Romans. We'll start in that book. I'm so excited about that study. And we're also going to be giving away a transformer. Now, you're going to learn more about that on Easter Sunday, but I'm telling you what, you're going to love it. It's going to be very, very exciting. So today is Palm Sunday. We're celebrating by wrapping up the book of Philippians. This has been a tremendous book for myself and for my family. As we study this book, it has so much to offer our relationships. So we're going to do a little review today, and then we'll wrap the book up. The big idea as we've been studying this is to enjoy the people in my life, I need to invest in my relationships. So we've been talking about how to invest in our relationships. Week one, we talked about investing in thinking the best. I hope you've been practicing that. Paul said, I thank God every time I think of you. So I hope you've been practicing that this week and last week, just saying, I thank God that God has brought you into my life. And practice that. Continue to practice that. I thank God for you being in my life. And then the second way we talked about investing in our relationships is investing in an eternal perspective. And Paul said, God who began a good work in us will continue that work until the day of completion. So if we could have faith that God is working, even behind the scenes when we don't see it, Jesus is working in me, he's working in you. So believe in marriage breakthroughs. Believe in relational breakthroughs. Believe in parental breakthroughs. The prodigal son will come home. Believe that God is working. So the third way we talked about investing in relationships is investing in reducing conflict. Now, how do we do that? Well, Paul says, have you experienced the love of Christ in chapter 2? Have you experienced his love? And if you know Christ, then you've experienced his love, his mercy, his grace. He says, we are to have the same attitude that Christ had. So Jesus, being God, came down from heaven and put on flesh in order that he could die for our sins. He became a servant for us. So if we could imagine just trying to be a servant to one another, caring about each other's needs. And so our remember verse has been thinking of the needs of others, right? So how do you invest in conflict resolution there is you start to serve one another. You do this with humility. Fourth week, we talked about investing in exercising our faith. And that's one of our principles as a church is that we're going to teach life application of God's word. And as we apply it in our life, it will bless us, it'll bless our families, and it'll bless our communities. So investing in exercising our faith. And then the fifth way we talked about investing in our relationships is investing in joy. We find joy in our salvation. We can rejoice in our relationship with the loving and merciful God. We can find joy in the blessings that God has brought into our lives. And so rejoicing helps our relationships. And the sixth way we talked about investing was to let go of our past. Let go of our past failures, our past hurts, even letting go of our past successes. In order to move forward, we have to let go. Jesus described it this way. If you're trying to plow a field and you look back, you're going to start to be wavy, right? And the same is true in our relationship with God and others. We need to keep our focus forward, keep our focus on Christ. So let go of the past. And then the seventh way we talked about last week was investing in a worry-free attitude. And so not a stress-free attitude, but a worry-free attitude. So we learn to worship rather than worry. We learn to give our concerns, our hardships over to the Lord and trust that He cares for us. Well, today we're going to wrap up the message on the book of Philippians in investing in contentment. And I think this is something our culture really doesn't understand too well. Contentment. Contentment is being satisfied in what you have. But the problem is today, you know, we mortgage our future for our wants of today, don't we? I mean, we may not be able to afford it, but wait a minute. We got a credit card. We got credit, and so we'll buy it on credit. We may want to get married sometime, but why get married? We'll just move in together, and we don't know what it means to delay our gratification, to wait on God's timing. I think we could learn a lot on this topic here of contentment. Just think about how contentment could help you in your marriage, help you in your family. If we, instead of push things ahead of our financial means, push things ahead of timing, that we waited for the right timing in things, how that would be easier on the stress of our family and how we could see God bless us. So I want to talk about three ways that we can invest in contentment. The first way is by learning to avoid comparisons. This is something we all do, right? We compare, and we compare with, you know, our neighbors, we can compare with others, we compare our cars, we compare our houses, we compare our clothes, our hairstyles, we compare everything, you know. And what's interesting is we usually compare up, you know, we kind of compare our worst to someone's best, you know, like you look at Facebook and it's like, oh, I wish I had, and that is always dissatisfying. So look what Paul says here. In chapter 4, verse 10, I'll pick it up here. Paul, he says, I greatly rejoice in the Lord that at last you have renewed your concern for me. Indeed, you have been concerned, but you had no opportunity to show it. He's talking about their giving financial support of the mission field. He says, I am not saying this because I'm in need, for I have learned to be content whatever the circumstances. Being content, being satisfied with God's provision at this moment. There's seasons, right? There's seasons. So being satisfied with what you have. And that's an important attribute that we all need to learn. Jesus described this in a parable of the parable of the rich fool in Luke chapter 12, where this guy, he had plenty. He had more than enough, and then he hit one of those banner years. And if you've noticed in life, there's usually every, I don't know, so many years, you hit a low point, right? Financially, you're struggling, and then all of a sudden, you know, a couple more years later, you're in a good point, and things are going well. Well, this is that good point. He's on the top of the bell curve. Everything's going his way, and he's got so much. He decides, you know what, I'm going to tear everything down, all my barns and everything. I'm going to rebuild and you know, so I can store up even more food and more, you know, finances. And by the time he's done with all of it, it's at the end of his life. His time's up. And now all of us, you know, we don't know how many days or how many years we have. It's a gift by God. To spend our life always wanting more, we'll never be satisfied. Years ago, Rockefeller was the richest guy in America, and someone asked him, you know, how much money is needed to really be content? I mean, how much money does a person really need? And he had a really wise response. You know what he said? He said, just a little bit more than you have. And it's that desire. I want more. I want more. And to be content, learning to stop comparing with others. No one wins. No one wins with comparison. So it just breeds dissatisfaction. So first step is I'll invest in contentment by learning to avoid comparisons. It just brings dissatisfaction. And then second, I'll invest in contentment by learning to adjust to change. Adjust to change, because life is always changing. There are seasons in life, and you know, and if we can acknowledge those seasons, there's times that, you know, maybe you have very little. It's scarcity time. You know, and then there's other times where it's like, you know, we have more. We have more than scarcity. We're doing better, you know. And then there are those times, like the rich fool, where it's just abundant, you know, and you have plenty. Adjust to the change in life, because it's constantly changing. I think we learned this through the last year with the pandemic. You know, life changed radically overnight. It wasn't a three-year or three-week curve, it wound up being a year, you know, and we had to adjust in many different ways. There's seasons. Now, being content, there's some bad teaching out there. I just want to kind of bring this up. There's teachers out there that will teach that God wants everyone poor. You know, if you know him, he wants you to take the poverty vow, you know, and that's not found in scripture. So that's just bad teaching all around. It's taking half of a verse, you know. And then there's the opposite side. There's teachers out there that teach that you should be abundant. You're a child of the king, so you should live like a child of the king, and God will just totally bless you financially all the way. And that's not good teaching either. And so there's a lot of teaching in the Bible about saving, being wise with your investments, building up over time. There's a lot of good teaching in the Bible for that. It doesn't teach the both extremes, okay? There are godly rich people in the Bible. Job, he's one of them. He was extremely wealthy, and he was never condemned for his wealth. In fact, at the end of his life, God blessed him double fold. And we can be generous when we're wealthy and blessed by God. And living here in America, we are blessed in so many ways. We have, I think, the best medical that there is to offer, and we have great education. We have so much. We have so much to be thankful for. Look what Paul says. He says in verse 12, he says, I know what it is to be in need. And I think most people have probably experienced that at least once in their life, if not every few years, you kind of experience that. I know what it is to have plenty. And I think if we can be honest, most of us have experienced that too, where food was so much, it's like you look in the refrigerator, I don't want anything, I'm just going to get fast food, you know, and you got what you need. And then he goes, I've learned the secret of being content in any and every situation, whether well-fed or the opposite, or hungry, whether living in plenty or in want. The secret of contentment, knowing that God has provided for your needs, you know, and not comparing, not looking farther down the road, but being satisfied with where you're at this moment, in this season of life, that God has brought you the right finances, that God has brought you the right people, that God has brought you the right place to live, that God is taking care of you, being content with what God has given you. I think this is important. I look at a parable Jesus gave about the kingdom of heaven. This was in Matthew 20, and it was a parable of the landowner. And the whole idea is, this is about the kingdom of heaven, that God gives us heaven at no cost to us. It's the cost is all on the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. So if you think about that, which one of us deserves heaven? None of us do. And so the parable goes like this. The landowner, he comes and he looks for people and he goes, would you like to earn a day's wage today? And people are like excited, yes, I would love to earn a day's wage. And so they go to the field and they start working. Then at the third hour, he goes and finds some more people. Would you like to come and work and get a full day's pay? And they're like, yes, we'd love that. And even though it's 3 hours into the workday, yes, fantastic. And then sixth hour comes, and he goes and he finds more people. Would you like to work in the field and get paid today? And I'll give you a full day's wage. And then the ninth hour comes. It's close to the end of the day, and we're not farmers, most of us are not, but you know, during harvest time, you're working 12 hours, sun up to sun down. And it's close to the end of the day, and he says, hey, it's the ninth hour. Would you like to come and work? And he offers them a full day's wage. Heaven is a gift. None of us deserve heaven, and yet God so graciously, through the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ, he gives us heaven. He gives us our biggest need, the need of salvation. And to remind ourselves that we have no right to be jealous, no right to look to someone else and see that maybe they're doing a little bit better financially or whatever. Comparing that, it just doesn't work. I like this passage here in Romans 8 because I think sometimes we do compare. Sometimes we do look at God and go, God, where are you when we're maybe in want, maybe in need, maybe in a struggling place in life, or maybe it's a health issue, that a crisis that you're going through and you're struggling and you're feeling like, God, you know, where are you? And you're comparing yourself with others. And again, we always compare up. We never compare down. Paul says in Romans 8:35, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship? I'll just pause for a moment. Isn't that times we think, God, where are you? I got trouble. Why is the season so hard? Or persecution, or famine, or nakedness, or danger, or sword. You start to think, God's abandoned you. He hasn't abandoned you. He's with you. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. God is with you. He's with me. Even in the hard times and in the times of plenty, if we can be content in his provision, knowing that God loves us and he cares for our needs. You know, Paul was at a time in his life where he had a physical ailment, and we're not sure exactly what that ailment was, except it made it difficult for him to write. And he penned a third of the New Testament. He penned a lot of these books. And as he was struggling, whether it was his eyesight or his hands, as he was struggling to write, he prayed and he asked God to heal him. And even though God used Paul to heal other people, God chose not to heal Paul. But he said his grace was enough for him. Sometimes when we are in want, in need, Christ is lifted up in our life. People see that you're in need. People see that you're in pain and you're in struggling here. But they see that God is supplying your need and giving you the strength to walk through it. Sometimes that's a fantastic, amazing testimony. Trust that God is with you. He's more than sufficient for all of your needs. Nothing separates us from God's love. So first step, I will invest in contentment by learning to avoid comparison. We always lose when we compare. Second step, I'll invest in contentment by learning to adjust to change. There's going to be change. There's going to be times that you're struggling and times you're going to have more than enough. Learn to adjust and trust that God is the same God that loves you. He's provided your salvation through Jesus Christ. And then the third step, I'll invest in contentment by learning to trust God to meet my needs. Whatever your need is, whether it's physical, whether it's financial, whether it's relationship, whatever your need is, a roof over your head, whatever your need is, trust that God cares and he will provide in his timing and his way. We read this in Philippians 4:13. It's probably one of the most popular verses in Philippians 4. It says, I can do everything through him who gives me strength. Can't you just see that on a t-shirt, you know, a guy that's doing a marathon, you know, I can do anything through Christ who gives me strength. And that's a great verse, and you can use that in many situations, but understand, Paul is referring to having very little, to having enough to get by, or having plenty, no matter what your situation is. He's talking about kind of like real-life third-world problems, not first-world problems. He's saying Christ is enough. I like the Amplified translation in this verse. The Amplified just kind of expands on each of the Greek words here. And Paul says, I am ready for anything and equal to anything. Isn't that neat? Ready for anything, equal to anything. Through him who infuses inner strength into me, I am self-sufficient in Christ's sufficiency. I'm not self-sufficient in my sufficiency. I'm self-sufficient in Christ's sufficiency. In Christ, I can do all things. You know, and whatever it might be, whatever you're struggling with, God is more than enough. He will supply all of your needs. He is with you. The rest of this chapter, Paul highlights the people in Philippi because they understood the idea of missions beyond their community. Churches at this time, you know, they're beginning to grow, and most of them are Jewish churches. Understand it was the Jewish faith that Jesus is the Savior of, right? But he's the Savior of the whole world. And all along, God has said that the Jewish people would be a light to the nations to help more people around the world, you know, follow God and love God. But they weren't getting it. And the church in Philippi was the first church that really understood mission work to help people find and follow Jesus in their community, as well as the community outside of them and throughout the world. And so Paul, he says in verse 14, he says, yet it was good for you to share in my troubles, because they gave, right, financially to the mission field. Moreover, as you Philippians know, in the early days of your acquaintance with the gospel, when I set out from Macedonia, not one church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving, except you alone. They were the first church that got the vision. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me aid again and again when I was in need. So not just in Philippi, but also in Thessalonica. They were providing for the mission of helping more people understand God's word. Not that I'm looking for a gift, but I'm looking for what may be credited to your account. I have received full payment, and even more, I am amply supplied. Now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, they are a fragrant offering, an acceptable sacrifice, pleasing to God. Paul is at a time now where he has more than enough. He is sufficiently amplified, supplied, right? And then verse 19, and we'll wrap it up here in this verse. Then he says, my God, your God, and my God will meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. Hasn't God met your needs? Spiritually, the greatest need that all of us have is a need for eternal life. And God has graciously given us the free gift of eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Jesus took our sins upon him and died in our place and rose again on the third day. He takes our sins, pays for them, and he gives us his righteousness. He has supplied our deepest need spiritually and physically and emotionally. He cares for all of our life. So learning to be content is the key today. So what is likely to upset your contentment? What is it? Is it a health crisis? Is it a financial crisis? Can you trust? Will you trust that God is sufficient, that He will provide for your needs? Not every want, but your needs. But I might say, often He provides for our wants as well. He is a good, gracious God. So here's some next right steps for us to take. First step is by choosing to stop comparing your situation with others. Stop looking to the left, to the right. Stop looking at your neighbors. Stop looking at other people that are doing better on Facebook. Just stop comparing. No one wins. It just brings dissatisfaction. Then the second thing you can do is writing down how Christ is sufficient in your circumstances, how He gives you the strength to do whatever is needed. In your weakness, Christ will make a beautiful testimony of your life. And then also another step could be writing down how you need to change your perspective. So maybe right now there's a perspective of looking for more, wanting more, instead of seeing how God has already blessed you with so much. Just encourage you to apply this in your own personal life. Now, if you have not invited Christ into your life as your Savior and Lord, I encourage you to do that today. Next week, I want you to celebrate Easter as a believer in Christ. And then if you have accepted Christ, I'd like to encourage you for the next step of believer's baptism. So if you're interested in that, please let us know. I'd love to contact you, connect with you, pray with you, and celebrate with you. Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, You are so loving, so forgiving. Lord, Your grace abounds to us, that You love us every day. Your mercies are renewed every day. God, You provide for our deepest need spiritually. Lord, You have made us right with You through Jesus Christ's substitutional death for us. We thank You. We praise You for this. God, I know I compare. I think all of us struggle with comparing. We look around, we see somebody that has something way better than us, and Lord, that brings heartache. That brings dissatisfaction. And we forget to see how much You've blessed us. Lord, I pray that our eyes would be open today and this week on how many blessings You've poured out into our life. Spiritual blessings with a home in heaven. A relationship with You. Lord, You bless us with friendships. You bless us with this amazing church of people that love and care for each other. God, You bless us with family and friends. Lord, You bless us with a roof over our heads and food to put on our tables. So, Lord, we want to say thank You today. We love You. We worship You. Thank You for Your generosity. And as we're praying right now, if you have not invited Christ into your life, I want to encourage you to do so right now. Just take this moment to get real and be honest with God. To say, Dear Jesus, I acknowledge I'm a sinner. I fall short of Your holiness. And Jesus, I understand that You love me so much that You came down from heaven and You went to the cross, taking my sins, and You died in my place, and You rose again on the third day. Jesus, I believe in You. I believe You died for me and rose again. I confess You as my Lord and Savior. I ask that You come into my life, that You forgive me of my sins and give me a home in heaven. Help me now to live my life to honor You the best I know how. It's in the powerful name of Jesus I pray. Amen. If you made a decision today, whether it's being content, whether it's your faith in Christ or you want to be baptized as a believer, please let me know. I'd love to celebrate with you and encourage you in your faith. You can let me know after the service here on campus, or you can text me at 858-682-2424. That number again is 858-682-2424. Just a reminder, on Easter Sunday, I want to encourage you to be on campus if you can, if you feel comfortable. We'd love to have you here at 9:15 or 11 o'clock. We have some very special gifts for you. We're going to have the devotional on the book of Romans. We're going to have the Case of Christ for You by Lee Strobel. And we're also going to have a transformer for you as well. You're going to love that. All right, let's continue to worship with Pastor Joey.
I see the King of Glory coming on the clouds with fire. The whole earth shakes, the whole earth shakes. Yeah. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. The people sing, the people sing. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. I see His love and mercy washing over all our sin. People see, I see a generation rising up to take their place with selfless faith, selfless faith. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Heal my heart, heal my heart and make it clean. Open up my eyes to the things unseen. Show me how to love like You have loved me. Break my heart for what breaks Yours. Everything I am for Your kingdom's cause. As I walk from earth into eternity.
With our hearts together, come on. Worship the God who heals, He saves. Sing Hosanna.
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
Hosanna,
Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna, Hosanna.
Hosanna in the highest. Hosanna in the highest.
We worship you, Jesus. We worship you. Hosanna in the highest. Thank you that you save us, you renew us, you restore us, God. We worship you. Be with all the church family at home. Keep them safe. Watch over, protect them. Continue to encourage us this week. Show us your love, your joy, your passion, God. And bring us back here safely next week. We give you all the glory, all the honor, all the praise. All the family say, amen. Cornerstone family, thank you so much for joining us online today. If you feel comfortable, join us live every single Sunday, 9:15 online, and also 9:15 and 11 in our beautiful main sanctuary. And don't forget to subscribe to us on YouTube and share and like us on Facebook and Instagram.
Thank you so much for your generosity. We're excited. This coming Sunday, just a week from today, is Easter Sunday. We'd like to invite you to come on campus, either at the 9:30 service or 11 o'clock service, or join us online and just celebrate Easter with us. Until next Sunday, God bless.
God bless you.